Good morning, and as you come in to prepare yourselves for worship, let me read to you from the Apostle Paul, who gives us a reminder of what we should be thinking when we come to worship our God. Hear now from Paul's letter to the Romans. For none of us lives to himself, and none of us dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's.
Thank you. Hello, good morning, and welcome to worship this morning. If you're visiting with us, a special welcome to you. We've come to worship God. We're going to hear from His Word as He summons us into His presence. Then we're again going to stand together to sing the doxology and to sing the doxology and then to pray together. And we'll remain standing for our opening hymn, which is number 100 in the book you'll find in the rack in front of you. So let's hear the word of God from John chapter 4, Jesus' words. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship Him. God is spirit, and those who worship Him must worship Him in spirit and truth. To grieve the Holy Spirit in our daily lives, we come together as His people to confess our sin and hear His pardon. Let's pray together using words you'll find in the bulletin. Let's all pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, we confess that we have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts, and have offended against your holy laws. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear this word of reassurance, Christian brother and sister. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we praise you that to you belongs the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty, that all in the heavens and in the earth is yours, and that yours alone is the kingdom, and that you are exalted as head over all. We acknowledge that all riches and honor this world has to give come from you, that with everything we have and are and hope to be, you rule over all, that though there are influences and powers and authorities, all power and might is in your hand, and that though we may make it well in the world and become great in the eyes of the world, or may feel this morning that we are weak and insignificant, that it's in your hand to make great and to give strength to all. We thank you, our God, and we praise your glorious name in the strong name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. Responsive reading today is Psalm 118. We'll be reading verses 1 through 16. Psalm 118 is found on page 511 in the Pew Bible. I'll be reading the odd-numbered verses, and you would join in the even-numbered verses. After we have the responsive reading, we'll stand to sing the Gloria Patri, and then recite together an old confession of the faith, the Apostles' Creed. Psalm 118, found on page 511, verses 1 through 16. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his steadfast love endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord say, his steadfast love endures forever. Out of my distress I called on the Lord. The Lord answered me and set me free. The Lord is on my side. I will not fear. What can man do to me? The Lord is on my side as my helper. I shall look in triumph on those who hate me. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in princes. All nations remember me. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They surrounded me on every side. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They surrounded me like bees. They went out like fire among thorns. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. I was pushed hard so that I was falling, but the Lord helped me. The Lord is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. Glad songs of salvation are in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord exalts. The right hand of the Lord is valiantly.
Would you join me now in approaching our great and merciful God in prayer? Let us pray. Our good and gracious God, we thank you. We thank you again that you are worthy of all praise. We thank you again that we can even come into your presence, knowing that you hear us because of Jesus. So we come in his name, thanking you, our God, that you are worthy of all praise. We thank you, our Lord, that we enter a new season, and we thank you that, as your word declares, for everything there is a season and a time for every purpose under heaven. We thank you that you are the God of all seasons, and we praise you, our God, that we come to one who can be trusted in every season of life, because you, the Lord God Almighty, the Holy One, are the unchanging God in an ever-changing world. We thank you that we come to one who is the same yesterday, today, and forever, who will never change. And as the seasons change, even in nature, as we about to embark on the fall season and anticipate new things going on in that season, we praise you, our God, that you are the steadfast God, not only of nature, but of life itself. For we are approaching different seasons of life as well. We celebrate many births already here in this church. Father, we thank you for that new season of life you have given. We celebrate new thresholds that people are crossing even now. And we thank you for that, Lord God. We thank you, too, that you are faithful in every season. And, Father, this year we know that some will face that final season of life. And we thank you that in every season we have a God who never changes. And we pray, our God, that you would help us see it's because of your unchanging love, because of your unchanging promises that we find in your word again and again, that you are a God who will never leave us, never forsake us, who will always be merciful to those who cry out in the name of your Son. You will forgive sins. You will restore the brokenhearted. You will heal those in need. God, we thank you that we come to a Lord who is the same in every season of life. And God, we ask even now that you would help us. Help us as we face new changes, new seasons. Help us to face them with confidence, not with fear. Help us to remember that you are sufficient and your love is sufficient in every season. And it's all because of the finished work of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord, who has given us everything we need in every season of life. Oh God, thank you. Thank you for your faithful and permanent love. Lord, we ask especially that you would bring that love to bear in this broken and changing world. We look around us, Father, and to even look for a moment at what's happening around us, the wars, the rumors of wars, the hatred, the despair, the killing. Oh God, our hearts are heavy if we would just pause and look at the depth and the brokenness of sin in our world. Would you have mercy, our God? We ask as well that you would intervene in our own local government. Father, thank you for the men and women you have put in positions of authority, but keep them humble, our God. And use them as instruments of grace, even in this community, where it's a daily thing that we are too easily getting used to, that people are killing one another, even in our city. Oh, God, have mercy. Have mercy. We ask that you would continue to watch over us as a body of believers here at 10th Church. And especially as we see new students coming into this area, a new season of life for them, we pray that you help us be a welcoming place to give hope and encouragement in this new season. We pray the same thing for all of our students who are beginning their own threshold of education. We pray that you would bless them and the teachers and the faculty, and especially here at 10th as we start this fall, that you would bless our teaching, Father, with your presence. Lord, we also ask that you would have mercy on those of us in need. We think tragically of this Curtis student who was recently died in an accident. Father, that community, would you have mercy on that community and help us to know how to best reach out to them as well. Lord, we pray that you would make us a church that trusts fully in you, that lives clearly for you, and that declares constantly that Jesus Christ is Lord. Have mercy on us, even this hour, that we would live for you. And we pray in Christ's holy and precious name. Amen. Well, again, welcome. And before I give you some further announcements, as I mentioned, this is the beginning. The beginning is new things happening for us here. And we have new things happening here at 10th Church. We have a new face that you might have heard the name, but now we're going to put a name with a face. Our new musician, Colin Holland, is here among us. And we're going to have Frank Carter, one of our ruling elders, bring that young man up here so you can see and be excited about what we are excited about as well, the blessing that God has brought to 10th Church. Frank.
Good. Thank you. So about 18 months ago, the session began to search for a new music director, and many of you will know that the search was successfully completed late in the spring, and that today is Collins Howland's first day on the bench as our new music director. So it's my privilege to welcome Colin and to do a short introductory interview. So welcome. So of first importance, one of the things is the Howland family is joining our church family. So Colin, would you help us get acquainted with your bride and children?
Yes, excuse me, they've actually chosen a very safe place up in the far corner of that balcony over there. But my lovely wife, Robin, of 25 years, is here as are two of our daughters, our younger two, Kirsten, who is going to be in ninth grade at Philmont Christian Academy, and Anna, who's going to be in sixth grade at Philmont. Our oldest, sadly, we have left at Gordon College. As of a week ago, she's a freshman up there.
Great, thanks. Now, the session sought a man with substantial both professional and spiritual credentials. And from that part of this work, I know that one of the more interesting aspects of this story is how you came to reform faith. Could you just share a little bit of that story with us?
Yes, I grew up in a denomination different than this, but I've worked my whole full-time career in PCA churches, and that first church I served was at Coral Ridge Presbyterian Church in Fort Lauderdale, and my first 6 months there, D. James Kennedy was preaching a series of sermons on the great doctrines of grace, and about 6 weeks in, the title of the sermon for Sunday evening was Predestination. And I had been taught in school and other places that really the Calvinists who believe that kind of thing, you know, lived several centuries ago and burned witches in New England. I had no idea that anybody believed that kind of thing. And Dr. Kennedy was very kind to walk with me through that and to point me to some resources, and through his preaching and the reading of the works of Charles Spurgeon, but also Foundations of the Christian Faith by James Montgomery Boyce, I came to a reformed understanding of the Christian faith.
Great. And then could you also share a little bit of your professional musical credentials?
I grew up in this area, studied with Keith Chapman, who was the organist at Wanamaker's for many years, attended Curtis Institute of Music, and then have a master's degree from Baylor University.
Great. Finally then, if you could share with us a couple of your some of your thoughts about your initial goals here at Temp.
We're all part of the family of God. This is a big family. And I look forward to meeting you, and I think for the first bit of time that I'm here, I think that's really the most important thing, so that I can know better how to serve you with our music ministry.
Great, thank you. Okay. So let me say a couple more things while we're giving Colin a chance to get back to his place here. Many of you have been praying for the Howland family over the course of the summer. I want to thank you for that. And they did complete a very busy transition from Dallas this summer. And then lastly, I want to formally recognize and thank the search committee. This particular group worked hard and very well together, and I want to thank people for their service. And I would share with you one of the particular joys of this group was the music they made in my living room over the course of the past 18 months. The members of the committee, I'm going to read their names. There were elders Fred Hill, Hugh Taylor, Jim Halla, and members Alma Zensen, Cheryl Woods Olson, Cynthia Schwartz, David Fay, Richard Harlow, and Nate Fletcher. And that was the group that did the work that brought Colin to us. Thank you.
Again, we're very excited for the Lord's blessing on us, but please take time to meet Colin and welcome him and encourage he and his family as well as they start their new beginning as well here at 10th. Welcome one and all, and if you are new with us, we are grateful that you're here and trust that you will be blessed by our worship together, that it would really glorify God and point all of us to who it is that we are here for, Jesus Christ, the living King. I won't take time to read it, but I think one of the best welcoming things you'll find is on the front page of our bulletin. That's something that you can have a tendency to gloss over, but it says very clearly what we are about as a church and who it is that we want to serve and how we want to welcome you in His name. There are pew cards in front of you that are welcoming cards. If you're new among us, we encourage you to take time to fill one out. Put that in the offering plate when it comes by and let us know of any way we can particularly help you. I want to highlight a few quick announcements. One is our 10th College Fellowship, which is getting well geared up for this fall, and 10th City Network are both having welcoming lunches today. You can look in the bulletin if you fit in any of those categories or just want to go hang out with younger people. Go ahead and do that and find out how you can be involved in that. Also, to remind you that next Sunday, at our early service is our day of prayer, and we'll be praying for the ministries of 10th Church. And please be aware of that we start each quarter with our Sunday school hour praying for the needs of this church as well. There are a lot of many opportunities in the bulletin that you can be a part of, but as you'll see, prayer is a pretty strategic thing. We have a place offering for you after the service. If you want personal prayer, there are people who love to pray with you and for you. You can see information on that as well. But one of our newest staff members, Gavin, has been introducing us to what it means to really pray together as a body of believers. And so Gavin's going to come and remind you of a great opportunity that is before us. Gavin, welcome.
Well, it was in the late 1800s that William Pratt Breed was ministering here at 10th Church as the second of the famous B's. And under his ministry, there was a variety of emphases. One of the key ones, at least in my reflection, was him gathering the young people of the church there in the 1870s, 1880s to pray before the service and to pray after the service. And as we now enter into another season of prayer, I want to inform you about our young adults ministry, 10th City Network, which hosts a prayer dinner for the whole church. So what that means is that the young adults come and they prepare the dinner, and then everybody else is invited to join us at 6:45 this Tuesday for 30 minutes of sitting around tables, eating, getting to know somebody you don't know, and then from 7:15 to 8, we'll pray. We'll pray for 10th Church for 15 minutes. We'll read a passage, reflect on it, and pray. We'll read a passage, and then we'll pray for Philadelphia, that God would draw many people to Himself in our neighborhoods and in our campuses and various parishes surrounding 10th. And then we'll read another passage, and we'll respond in prayer, asking God to send out laborers to the nations, that He would strengthen our partners who are already there, and that those who have no way to hear the name of Jesus would find someone who could tell them the good news. And so 10th has a legacy of gathering young people to pray. It's happening for 130 years now, 140 years, and we want to continue that and expand it. It's not just a prayer dinner for the young adults, it's for everyone. And so I invite you this Tuesday, 6:45 to 8 in Fellowship Hall, to join us for a prayer dinner. And I don't have a historical referent for the lunches that are happening today, but I'm pretty sure our young people ate back then as well. So if you are a young adult, continue 10th's legacy, go out onto the steps, join someone for lunch. You're going to walk around somewhere in the city, find something to eat. If you're a college student, head directly below us in the catacombs, and we'll have some pizza down there until about 2. So 10th College Fellowship down below, 10th City Network out on the steps. My name is Gavin Baropoulos. Would love to meet any of you. Thanks.
Thank you.
gracious Father, we thank you that we can sing triumphantly because of your grace. And we ask that you would take these tithes and offerings, and Father, indeed, multiply them, use them powerfully, that others would join us in singing your matchless love and praises. And we ask this in Christ's name. Amen. Please be seated.
Reading is found on page 509 of the Pew Bible. It's Psalm 110. Let us give attention to the reading of God's word. The Psalm of David. The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. The Lord sends forth from Zion your mighty scepter. Rule in the midst of your enemies. Your people will offer themselves freely on the day of your power. In holy garments from the womb of the morning, the dew of your youth will be yours. The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. The Lord is at your right hand. He will shatter kings on the day of his wrath. He will execute judgment among the nations, filling them with corpses. He will shatter chiefs over the wide earth. He will drink from the brook by the way. Therefore, he will lift up his head. This is God's word.
Keep your Bibles open at this psalm. That's the last of our summer psalms that we've been looking at over these summer months. And it raises a question. Suppose it were possible to overhear God speaking. Well, how would that be possible? Is that something that is even something we can imagine or conceive? And there is an answer to that question in the New Testament when the Apostle Paul is writing to the Corinthians, for example. He talks about what might be on the mind of God. He says it like this: what no man eye has seen or ear heard or the heart of man imagined, what God has prepared for those who love him. So he's talking about things that are invisible, inaudible, and inconceivable to our minds and understanding. The things that are on the mind and in the heart of God. And yet he goes on to say that these things that are on God's mind and that God is speaking and saying have been revealed to us through the Spirit. That's key. He then goes on to give an illustration. For example, he talks about the illustration of us as human beings. He makes this comment: who knows a person's thoughts except the spirit of that person? Now you may say immediately, well, in my experience, in my house, apparently my husband or my wife knows exactly what's on my mind before I say it. Well, I get that from time to time. I'm told, I know what you're thinking. And I want to say, oh, no, you don't. And I say, what do you think I'm thinking? And invariably, it's always a negative thing. And I'm not thinking a negative thing at all, actually, until that moment when that negative thought was put in my mind. Now I'm thinking. And I'm in for serious trouble when I get home today, of course. Protect me before I go. But that's the illustration that he uses. He says, the only person who really knows what's in your mind is you, the inner person, the spirit of the person. And he goes on to make this application: therefore, no one comprehends the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. And when he makes them known, he imparts this knowledge in words, not taught by human wisdom, but taught by the Spirit, so that spiritual truths are communicated in spiritual words. Now, when you bear that in mind, I want you to come back to this psalm that we are looking at this morning and to understand that when David is writing this psalm, he is writing it as a prophet. And the Lord Jesus himself understands that what's going on in this psalm is precisely what we have just looked at in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. The Spirit is taking things that are heard within the Godhead and is communicating to them to David, who is writing them down so that we have them in our hands today. Well, you say, Liam, how do you know that? Well, I know that because that is precisely the interpretation that Jesus himself gives to this psalm. In Mark chapter 12, for example, let me read to you Mark chapter 12. Don't look it up, just believe me and look it up later. Save time. Jesus is under fire. They're coming to get him. They're trying to find something on which they can trip him up or shame him in public by something that he has said. And Jesus takes the initiative. As he taught in the temple, Jesus said, how can the scribes say that the Messiah is the son of David? And then he goes on to say this: David himself, Jesus speaks, in the Holy Spirit, or by means of the Spirit, speaking by means of the Spirit, declared. And he quotes from Psalm 110, "The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet." Now Jesus says, David himself calls this individual, the Christ, my Lord. So how is he his son? And the people heard him gladly. What Jesus does to these people of his day is he presents them with a puzzle. It's an interpretive conundrum. He is critiquing their normal approach, or the approach certainly that many take today to this psalm, in which they think that David is talking about another Davidic king, just like him, another earthly king, that Messiah is in some way just another earthly king somewhere down the road who will come along and do great things for the people of Israel. No, Jesus says, David is speaking by means of the Holy Spirit. He is in the Spirit. He is speaking as a prophet, not as a private person. He is not drawing from what is in his own mind, as we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. But rather, the things that are known to the Spirit are being communicated by means of David to us today. He's being given the lines that God speaks, and he is speaking those lines, given the lines that the Father says to the Son, and is repeating those in this psalm. In other words, when you read this psalm, you have to understand there are two settings. David is reporting this in his own day and age, 1,000 years before Jesus was born, but he is reporting a conversation that is taking place in eternity, not in any moment of time, in eternity, in fact, in eternity prior, much prior to David's own period. The Lord, past tense, said to my Lord, and you see how he's taking us up into this conversation, this dramatic unfolding of the will and mind and heart and purpose of God as he speaks to the Messiah about what is in store for him. And what we learn from this psalm is, first of all, that we have a divine Messiah. We have a divine Messiah. The Lord said to my Lord. David is reporting a conversation that is past tense to David's own location in history. He is talking about the Lord. Do you notice that? It's all uppercase letters. That's the covenant God of Israel, Yahweh, the Lord, the Most High God. And he is talking to my Lord, that is David's Lord. The Hebrew word is Adonai. Adonai is interesting because Adonai was the word that the Jews preferred to use in place of that other word, Lord, in uppercase letters, that is sometimes transliterated Yahweh or Jehovah. The Jews still will not say that name. They will say Adonai instead of that name. In other words, it's the Lord who's speaking to the Lord. In the English, in the Greek translation of the Old Testament, the word kurios is used of both the first Lord and the second Lord. In other words, it's God talking to God. It's the Lord talking to the Lord. And in Mark chapter 12, Jesus leaves us in no doubt as to who this second Lord is. He argues with these people. That is the Messiah, isn't it? And if David is hailing the Messiah as his Lord, Adonai, then he is identifying the Messiah as God's son. He's identifying a Messiah whose lineage is more exalted than that of David. And that becomes even more apparent at the second part of verse 3. Simon Gathercole is a lecturer, professor at Cambridge University, and he points out that in verse 3, there is language about God the Father begetting this Son from all eternity. It's a very difficult a very difficult verse to translate from Hebrew, but the Septuagint helps us out here. And he uses, Gathercole uses the Septuagint translation that was 200 years before Jesus. Let me read it to you. With you is the sovereign authority on the day of your power, in the midst of the bright splendors of the holy ones, from the womb, before the dawn-breaking morning star appeared, I begot you. The voice is the voice of God. David is taking up, as you will, if you like, in the drama of this story. He is taking the part now of the Father and is using the Father's lines given to him by the Spirit. He is in the Spirit. He is expressing the Father's words to the Son, as the Father reminds the Son that he was begotten before the dawn-breaking morning star. The very first thing to be created was created. The Father is saying, I begot you before creation. You go back before creation. And do you notice he goes back before creation? But as you come nearer to us, there is a relation, there is talk of a womb. You come from the womb. In other words, he's looking backwards from the day of his authority and power, back to the womb, back to the dawn-breaking morning star, back before that to the begetting of the Son by the Father in eternity past. There's this movement going on. And Gathercole goes on to say, this Greek translation, favored by Jesus and the apostles for its accuracy, says that before the dawn of time itself in creation, the Messiah was begotten, not created or made, and that his human birth from the womb would be unusual, though natural, from the womb, and gives a hint of the virgin birth. Now, all of that is emphasizing the particular uniqueness of the Messiah as having been with God from the beginning. And that is precisely, of course, the way in which Jesus' hearers understood him. You go back to Mark chapter 12 and you find that these people from this point on were saying, "What blasphemy! This man is saying blasphemy. He's claiming to be pre-existent. He's claiming to be divine," as Jesus links the Messiah's role with that of the Son of Man in Daniel chapter 7. And there in Daniel chapter 7, Daniel has a vision of this heavenly figure who comes in the clouds of heaven, described as one like a Son of Man. He's given dominion and a kingdom, and all the peoples and nations and languages serve him. His dominion is everlasting. His kingdom cannot be destroyed. And Jesus, in Mark 12, links Psalm 110 with the heavenly power of God. He does it again in chapter 14 of Mark. The high priest said to him at his trial, "Are you the Messiah? Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed?" What the high priest is challenging him about there is, did we get what you meant when you quoted Psalm 110 and applied it to yourself? Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed? Are you connected more to God than to us? Jesus replies, "I am. And you will see the Son of Man," Daniel 7, "seated at the right hand of power," Psalm 110, "and coming with the clouds of heaven." David's Lord and the heavenly Son of Man of Daniel 7 are one and the same. A figure that transcends space and time. A heavenly being who lives in the immediate presence of God. Bart Ehrman, who argues that Jesus never ever intimated his own pre-existence or his divinity, reads this psalm as if it's addressed to some ancient king of Israel, period. But what Ehrman never does, what he never does, interestingly, is to grapple with Mark's account of how Jesus handles this text, or in fact, how the writer to the Hebrews handles this text. And having identified himself with the figure described in this psalm, having identified himself as the Messiah, Jesus has the first Lord Yahweh speaking to David's Lord Adonai in a time that was past tense to David's time. In other words, the Messiah is pre-existent and he is divine. We have a divine Messiah. Secondly, we have a kingly Messiah. Jesus applies this. David describes a conversation within the Godhead. He introduces it. The Lord says to my Lord, then he begins, in the character of the Father, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. David again, the Lord sends forth from Zion your mighty scepter. The Father takes up, rule in the midst of your enemies. Your people will offer themselves freely on the day of your power. David again, verse 4, the Lord has sworn. So look at what the Father says to the Son. Sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. To sit at the right hand of God was an honor higher than that afforded to any angel or archangel or any man. In Old Testament terms, it was unthinkable, even as a metaphor, even as a simple figure of speech, to think of a mortal sitting at the right hand of God. To be at God's right hand is to be God's equal, co-equal with God. That's the way Peter explains this in Acts chapter 2. You remember he's speaking from the perspective of the resurrection of Jesus. The resurrection transformed the way the early apostles read the Old Testament. It shed light where there was darkness before. And Peter, as he's preaching to the people on the day of Pentecost, announces that God has raised Jesus up and that they are all eyewitnesses to his resurrection. And that now his being exalted at the right hand of God, Psalm 110, and having received from the Father the promise of the Spirit, has poured out all that they were seeing and hearing. And he quotes from this psalm, and he says, you know, David did not ascend into heaven. David is not talking about himself or any other human figure here. When he said, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. And in summing it up, Peter says, therefore let all the house of Israel know for certain that God has made him, Jesus, both Lord and Messiah, this Jesus whom you crucified. And what God has done with this Jesus is to raise him up in power, in the day of his power. In verse 3, that language is used by the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 1 when he says that the resurrection of Jesus was at the resurrection, Jesus became the Son of God with power. That's the new status. He has always been the Son of God, but after the resurrection, he is the Son of God in power. To the glory of God the Father. And that's what we mean when we say that Jesus Christ today sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. He has all the power of the Godhead, all the authority of the Godhead, all authority in heaven and earth belong to him. And you can see that this is developed in the text, because the rest of the text is about Jesus as well. David interjects. The Lord sends forth from Zion your mighty scepter. The Greek translation puts it like this. The Lord God will send forth your rod of power, O my Lord, from Zion. From Zion. Beginning there, the power of this ascended Lord, this King, is going to move outwards from Zion to the ends of the earth. Justin Martyr, one of the early Christians, understood this verse as applying to the advance of the gospel. As the gospel makes the rule of Jesus effective in the hearts and minds of men and women through the powerful message of good news. It echoes the language of Psalm 2, where the Son rules over the nations with a rod of iron. Rule in the midst of your enemies, God says to him. You notice that he's going to subjugate his enemies. There are people among his enemies, your people, he refers to them, verse 3, who will offer themselves freely in the day of your power, in light of your resurrection. They will come to you and they will trust in you. They will offer themselves to you and they will surrender to you. Jesus is the King and his kingdom is advancing, and more people are bowing the knee to King Jesus. Thirdly, our King, our Messiah, is not only a divine Messiah and a kingly Messiah, he is a priestly Messiah. Look at verse 4, David again. The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. Now he's quoting the Lord. You are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Now the writer to the Hebrews sees this psalm as describing that moment when the pre-existent Messiah receives before the dawn of time his eternal priesthood in the order of Melchizedek. Now, the book of Hebrews is a great book. I want to preach that one day. People are already lining up telling me to do it and do it soon. And what we do when we're preaching through the book of Hebrews is we get to chapters 6 and 7, and they're very hard. So we blink and move on and hope that you haven't noticed. But seriously, chapter 6 and 7 take up this whole theme. This is an exposition, really, of what is going on here in Psalm 110 and verse 4. Because there, it talks about Jesus' ascension to the throne of heaven. It says about heaven behind the curtain where God is, Jesus has gone as a forerunner on our behalf, having become a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. And he goes on to give us a bit bio of Melchizedek in verses 1 and 2 of chapter 7. Melchizedek was a king of Salem, priest of the Most High God. He meets Abraham, the father of the church, the father of the faithful, the father of believers. He meets Abraham and Abraham bows to him. Abraham gives him tithes. Abraham receives a blessing from him. In other words, this priest is superior to Father Abraham. And the writer to the Hebrews points out that when you go back and you look at the story, very interestingly, this man, Melchizedek, appears out of nowhere. He comes, well, let me read to you. Verse 3 of chapter 7 of Hebrews, he is without father or mother or genealogy. There's no reference to his background, his genealogy, where he came from. In other words, he has neither beginning of days, nor is there any reference to his death, nor end of life. And so in the sense in which he appears on the scene in the Bible, he resembles the Son of God and therefore continues as a priest forever. He just is. You read the story of Melchizedek and he comes fully grown up onto the stage. He is what he is, a priest of the Most High God. There he stands, no past, no future, always there, always a priest, unchanging. David here reports the words of the Father to the Son saying, I've made you a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. There is a priesthood that transcends the normal priesthood of the Aaronic priesthood in Israel that lived and died and came and went and is now gone for good because there's no job for them to do. They spent their days offering sacrifices one after another. Every day you sinned, you made a sacrifice, the priest offered it. Every day for all of your life. Because every day you do something wrong, you need to confess it, you need a sacrifice, because something has to die, either you die or the victim dies, and so on. And on it goes until Jesus comes into the picture. On it goes until John the Baptist identifies Jesus as the Lamb of God who will take away the sin of the world. On it goes until Jesus in John 17 adopts the posture of the great high priest on the Day of Atonement, praying for himself and for his apostles and for the whole church. And there he is in that great moment before he is arrested as the great high priest, the only one qualified as a high priest in the line of Melchizedek. He offers to God, he consecrates the victim for the sacrifice that would carry away the sins of the world. And he says to the Father, "For my people's sake, I consecrate myself." Hallelujah. And he puts himself on the altar, as it were. He surrenders himself to the business of making one sacrifice for all time that can really do the business of putting away sin. One sacrifice. And Jesus comes as our priest. We need that priest to offer that sacrifice. And Jesus did it all. All to him I owe. And we need a priest to intercede for us, because we're always stumbling and falling, and we're always exposed to Satan and all his works, trying to undermine our faith, trying to knock us out the race, trying to destroy our faith. We have a high priest who ever lives, everlastingly lives, to make intercession for us. He's never going to die. He's never going to stop being there. He is never going to stop acting for us, pleading for us. Before the throne of God above, I have a strong, a certain plea, a great high priest whose name is Love, who ever lives and pleads for me. Amen. We have a high priest who is sympathetic to our cries, our staunch defender against all the accusations of the evil one. We have a high priest. So this Messiah is a priestly Messiah. He is a kingly Messiah. He is an exalted Messiah. And fourthly, he is a victorious Messiah. This whole passage really ends with a note of victory. He will drink from the brook, by the way. Therefore, he will lift up his head. That may be a reference to an incident similar to in David's life. It may be a reference simply to the fact that the Lord Jesus is in his humanity will be victorious. Mark Futato, who teaches Old Testament down in RTS in Orlando, translates the last verse like this: "He himself will be refreshed by brooks along the way. He will be victorious." That's the meaning of "he will lift up his head." He will be victorious. And there's no doubt that in these verses, it's the Lord and the Messiah together described as a divine warrior that goes out to fight for his people. In verse 1, he goes out in the name of and the power of the Lord to subdue enemies. In verse 2, to extend the kingdom. In verse 5, to shatter kings. In verse 7, to be victorious. And we're being reminded, you see, that the battle against evil in the world, the battle against the devil and all his works, the battle against sin in our own lives and sin in other people's lives, this battle is the Lord's battle. Sometimes we feel overwhelmed by demonic enemies and false teachers and wrong ideas and bad behavior. We become embattled, as it were, as we see everything around us going wrong in the world, and we are overwhelmed by the news reports. We're overwhelmed by the scandals in the church. We're overwhelmed by these things, and we come to this verse, and we're reminded that, listen, the battle is the Lord's. He is on our side. Hallelujah. And I want you to notice a subtle indicator of the relationship between the Lord and the Lord, between the Lord God and the Lord Messiah. I want you to notice, did you notice? Verse 1, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand. And verse 5, the Spirit says through the psalmist to the Messiah, the Lord is at your right hand. There is a unique insight into the inter-Trinitarian relationship, the relationship within the Godhead. As the Father exalts the Son to his right hand of power, the Father comes to Jesus' aid. He comes to his side, to his right side as his co-equal. He comes into the battle with the world, the flesh, and the devil to encourage and enable and strengthen his Son in the battle against sin. And you know, when Jesus comes onto the scene 1,000 years after David, when the Messiah comes, that is precisely what we see him do. We find him making war against the devil there in the desert. You remember, he's confronted by Satan. He makes war on Satan using the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, and he trounces Satan. Immediately he leaves there, he goes and starts healing disease and expelling demons. He is making war on sin. And he carries that war to the cross, where he defeats Satan in his own body as he bears the penalty for sin. As he kind of takes those enemies of God and he kind of hangs them out in public to dry, demonstrating their inadequacy. He is a mighty warrior. He is fighting for his people and his church, and he will be victorious. Hallelujah. Now, it's very interesting as you look at this psalm, how the psalmist ties together the beginning and the ending of this figure, pushing us back before the beginning of time, before the morning star has emerged, when he was begotten of God, and then pushing forward into eternity in the future, where he reigns over all and is triumphant over all. Kind of a principle there. Theological terms, language that comes from early Jewish theological thinking, and which was widely held in the ancient Near East at the time that Jesus was around. It's summarized in the expression Endzeit gleich Urzeit. That is not Glaswegian, by the way. It was meant to be German. And it really means this, that the primeval corresponds to the eschatological. I'll explain these in a moment. I just wanted you to know that I know those words. that protology corresponds to eschatology. Eschatology is to do with the last things, protology the first things. The glory of the Son in the past corresponds to the glory of the Son in the future. He was with God. He is with God. He shared glory with God. He shares glory with God. He is the A and the Z, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the ending. Hallelujah. He is all in all to his people. And right now that our Lord Jesus has been raised up by the Father, and he sits with the Father. It's one of those elements of the gospel, isn't it? That God raised him from the dead. He ascended up on high. He sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high. We call that his session. He is sitting. He has finished the work of redemption. He doesn't have any more to do. He sits there as a conqueror who has won the battle. And he reigns there on behalf of his church in ensuring that his church will triumph over the enemy. You remember what he said to his people. He said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Now, I don't want you to have a picture in your mind when you read that of a great army of tens of thousands of orcs bearing down on you, intent to destroy you. No, no. I want you to have in your mind Helm's Deep, a fortress. The orcs are all in there. It's the church that is outside, bearing down on the gates of the kingdom of darkness. Hallelujah. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. The very fact that you're here this morning and you're a believer, the very fact that there is a church in the world, the very fact that strongholds of Satan in people's minds and hearts are being leveled and torn down as men and women believe in him, trust in Jesus, believe that he is the only Savior, is a demonstration that Jesus is ruling the world in the interests of his people. And he will be victorious. He will lift up his head in victory. At the end of the day, Jesus wins. Jesus wins. And that's good news and bad news. It's good news if you're one of those people in verse 3 who offer themselves freely to him, who have given themselves over to him in the day of his power. It is terror to those who have resisted him and whose future is to be shattered in the day of his wrath and to be judged among the nations. So this morning, are you on the Lord's side? Can you say with David that Jesus Christ, the Messiah, is my Lord? My Lord. Father, we pray that today you would take your word and drive it home to our minds and hearts, illumine the dark places. Thank you that your Holy Spirit has taken of the things that were hidden and unheard and inconceivable to us and has made them known through the prophets, expressing those spiritual truths, those things that are beyond our ken, expressing them in words, spiritual words that you have given and that we find, for example, in this psalm. We bow the knee to him who died for us. We praise you for him in his strong name. Amen. peace from God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with you now and evermore. Amen. God be with you.